Welcome to Assistant on Air, where we have conversations with people that build for Google Assistant. I'm Jessica Dene Early-Cha, and I'll be your host today. I'm a developer advocate for Actions on Google, which means I create content to teach developers on how to build for Actions on Google, and I get their feedback to make the platform better. Today, we'll be chatting with Dan Myers. Welcome, Dan.
Thanks. Glad to be here.
So what do you do here at Google?
So I'm a developer advocate on the Google Assistant and Actions on Google developer platform team, where I work specifically on smart home, so controlling and automating your house using different IoT devices through Google Assistant.
Oh, that sounds like such a cool space to be in. And so the only smart thing I really know about and that I use every day is my lights. So can you go in more into detail about what's happening there?
Absolutely. So when you are developing any type of smart device with Google Assistant, there's a specific flow that you have to go through. So when a user says a command or says a different phrase to control their light, what's actually happening there is the Google Home or Google Home Mini is taking in the audio. It sends this up to Google's cloud for processing the natural language understanding engine. At that point, it actually goes to a partner's cloud for who that device is. So, for example, if it was a Philips Hue light bulb, right, it would actually be going to the Philips cloud service with a specific structure of JSON that matches the intent of what the user said. So if they said, turn on my light, there's a specific structure in JSON that is sent to Philips Hue's servers. Mm-hmm. And Philips then takes that and processes that information and sends it back down to the light bulb. So it's all done through Wi-Fi and internet connectivity.
Oh, that sounds awesome. So once if I'm a developer and I have my own thing that I want to connect to my Google Assistant, is that possible?
It is. So we have a variety of tools for developing your own smart devices, both in Node.js and Java. All of these different libraries come with samples, come with tutorials on how to build it. Yeah. So when developing for those, we have this list of different device types and a lot of different elements for this when developing.
Okay, so I'm assuming, because you said device types, does those device types mean that there's different functionalities for each device that's possible?
Yes. So the device type itself defines, you know, what type of icon might show up in different applications, things like that. And then there's device traits. And the device trait is what actually is used to define the capabilities of that device. So when you think of a smart light, you could have a light bulb that can turn on and off. You might have one that can dim. You might also have one that can change colors. And so you could even have one that does all three. Right, and so each of those are defined in different traits within the smart home library, and given to Google during the sync process.
Okay, so if I'm a developer and I'm building my own, I'm doing my own thing, do I have to worry about anything outside of just the functionality and saying the functionality, or do I still have to worry about how users might ask for this, like how to work with my device I've just made or connected to?
Right, and this is the beautiful part of Google Assistant for smart home, is that Google Assistant handles that natural language understanding for you. So as long as you have all of those capabilities defined, Google Assistant is able to take that and apply literally the infinite number of phrases that people can say to control that capability. So anything from, you know, turn down the lights just a little bit, right, to make it 50% less bright in the room, right? It's able to understand these different kinds of phrases and be able to control it appropriately.
Oh, that sounds great. For me, that just means as a developer, I can focus on my own thing and not have to worry about all of that, because that's a lot of overhead.
Absolutely. And that's, I mean, when you talk about NLU, that's a whole nother nut to crack.
No, definitely. So if I'm excited, I'm watching this video, what's the first thing I should do as a developer? I want to get onboarded. Is there something I should go to first?
My approach would be to instantly go to the code lab. The code lab is a complete walkthrough of every aspect from setting up your Google Cloud project to setting up on the Actions on Google console to setting up your Firestore, every aspect of developing a smart washing machine. So you get to see exactly what goes into a process like that.
That sounds awesome. Well, thank you, Dan, so much for hanging out with me and chatting with me. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks. So if you like today's show, please like the video. And if you have any comments or suggestions on what we just learned about today or what you want to learn about in the future, please put in the comments below. And feel free to follow us on Twitter for any updates and new videos. I've been Jessica, and chat with you next time.